Just 2 hours ago, Allied Air Forces began an attack on military targets in Iraq and Kuwait. These attacks continue as I speak. Ground forces are not engaged. This conflict started August 2nd when the dictator of Iraq invaded a small and helpless neighbor. Kuwait, a member of the Arab League and a member of the United Nations, was crushed, its people brutalized. 5 months ago, Saddam Hussein started this cruel war against Kuwait. Tonight, the battle has been joined.
On August 2nd of 1990, thousands of coalition soldiers, tanks, and artillery were deployed to protect the strategic border region of the oil-rich Ash-Sharqiya province in eastern Saudi Arabia. The Allies successfully repelled an Iraqi attack on the Saudi port of Kafji. The coalition forces then began a massive aerial bombardment on January 16, 1991, with thousands of US bombers targeting major Iraqi cities, oil depots, and military targets. The Allied plan of attack was to deceive the Iraqis into believing the main offensive would come from Kuwait, while the Allies would instead attack the Iraqis from the rear through the An-Najaf Desert, in what would become known as Operation Desert Storm. On the fateful morning of Sunday, February 24th, Allied armored battalions and marine divisions crossed into Kuwait and Iraq from Saudi Arabian bases on the border. The Iraqis lost 85 tanks, 40 armored vehicles, 30 wheeled vehicles, 2 artillery batteries, and over 1,000 infantry killed or captured. Kuwait was finally liberated, and although Iraq was devastated, nothing would change it as much as September 11th, 2001.
Our war on terror begins with Al-Qaeda, but it does not end there.
Following the horrific terror attacks on 9/11, the U.S. officially launched the war on terror, beginning with the invasion of Afghanistan, in order to topple the ruling Taliban warlords along with their Al-Qaeda supporters. The United States considered many Middle Eastern nations, including Iraq, as part of the Axis of Evil, a term that broadly described countries that supported terrorism by furnishing the terrorist groups arms and resources. In 2003, the United States UN Representative Colin Powell urged the other countries to join America in a war against Iraq, accusing Iraq of possessing weapons of mass destruction. Saddam, however, declared that all of Iraq's chemical weapons had been destroyed after Desert Storm. While the rest of the world was perplexed by the issue, the United States issued a 48-hour ultimatum to Iraq. Saddam Hussein and his two sons, Uday and Qusay, must flee Iraq before the 48-hour deadline, or the United States would invade the country with an international coalition. Saddam refused. Following the failed ultimatum, Washington sent out military advisors to the northern regions of Iraq in order to arm the local Kurds who resented Iraqi rule. This attack, coupled with an aerial bombardment of Iraq's capital, Baghdad, would take vital Iraqi troops away from the proposed Allied landing zones on the Alfa Peninsula. The coalition army then split up, with the British divisions occupying Basra on April 6th, and the American and other coalition divisions either traveling through the An-Najaf Desert or on the far side of the Euphrates River towards the northern approaches of Baghdad. The Allied advance, however, was postponed by several weeks by a massive sandstorm, but this only delayed the inevitable. On April 3rd, American troops reached the outskirts of Baghdad and engaged the local Iraqi militias at the Baghdad International Airport. After nearly a week of intense, close-quarters fighting, the U.S. finally obtained control over Baghdad on April 10th, and the Americans had finally achieved the triumph they desired for over a decade: the liberation of Iraq and the downfall of the Saddam Ba'athist regime. Saddam managed to escape Baghdad before the Iraqi surrender, but he was quickly captured by U.S. Special Forces on December 13th of the same year and was placed on trial before an Iraqi provincial court for war crimes. He was found guilty. He was later executed on December 30th, 2006. Following Saddam's capture in 2003, Bush declared mission accomplished and cessation of all combat activities in Iraq, as well as the beginning of the reconstruction. However, for the Iraqi people, the pain and suffering of the occupation was just beginning. The coalition began their occupation of Iraq by splitting it into four separate zones. Britain occupied the south zone around the city of Basra. Poland occupied the central zone situated around the city of Hilla, and the United States occupied the north and western zones containing Baghdad and Erbil, respectively. The majority of Iraqis had a positive opinion of the Americans, viewing them as liberators who were entering their nation to free them from Saddam's oppressive regime. Others, however, desired a return to Iraq's Saddam-era glory and prestige. Coupled with the incompetence of Allied-led infrastructure programs and Iraq's new provincial government, it was no surprise these dissidents turned to and thus revitalized the anti-Western insurgency. This also led to the birth of Islamic extremism in Iraq, who harassed not only coalition troops, but also Iraqi religious minorities such as the Yazidis and Christians. Despite the massive influx of coalition troops into these rebel-ridden cities in order to maintain law and order, the excess use of force on civilians only fueled the growth and numbers of these Iraqi insurgents. The culmination of tragedies in this American occupation was the Abu Ghraib prison affair. American Marines brutally humiliated and tortured Iraqi POWs and failed to respect basic human rights. The result of the Abu Ghraib affair was the exponential growth of Islamist fundamentalist insurgents paving a way for Al-Qaeda, under Zarqawi, to gain a foothold in Iraq. However, after losing control of their stronghold city of Fallujah and the death of Zarqawi by an Allied bomb, Al-Qaeda was left severely weakened. By 2011, the United States deemed Iraq safe enough for the removal of Allied troops, but this event would bring with it a new set of problems. The total costs of this occupation alone are a tragedy in and of itself. Nearly 200,000 Iraqis, most of whom were civilians, perished in the conflict, including men, women, and children. Over 2 million Iraqis, many of whom were minorities fearful of prosecution by radical Iraqi insurgents, were forced to flee their homes to safer areas. But the main tragedy of the U.S. withdrawal in Iraq was the rise of ISIS. ISIS quickly took control of the vacuum America left and occupied most of northern Iraq, including, most importantly, the major city of Mosul. The main concern for the U.S. is not the group itself, but its influence. ISIS has utilized social media to spread its message to every corner of the globe, and the West has felt this message all too many times. San Bernardino, Paris, Berlin, Sana'a, Ankara, Kabul, London, and the list goes on and on and on. The final result of the Iraq War was the alienation of the Western countries from the rest of the world, as anti-Western sentiment has proliferated from the Middle East to the rest of the Eastern world.
Thank you. Good night. And God bless America.
Even Jesus would never forgive what you do.